Hello guys, welcome to another video. Today we are going to talk about accounting for investments in debt securities. Especially, we are going to talk about available for sale securities. Before the start of accounting, let's have a quick overview. What is that debt security? Actually, debt security represents a creditor relationship with the issuer. It might include certain common forms of the debt like corporate bonds, maybe commercial paper. It might include certain additional types of debt, for example, mandatorily redeemable preferred stock that must be redeemed by the company. It might also include those preferred stocks which are redeemable at investors' option. It might also include collateralized mortgage obligation. Please note, leases, options, future contracts, forward contracts are not classified as debt securities. So when it comes to the accounting, so as an investor at the date of acquisition, you have to select one category out of these three categories for the accounting purpose. The first category is called held to maturity. So held to maturity securities are those debt securities where, as an investor, you have a positive intention and you have an ability to hold these securities until the maturity. So then second category is called trading. So if, as an investor, you have an intention to sell these securities in the near future or near term, that is called trading securities. If, as an investor, your intention is not clear, you did not classify as held to maturity or trading security, then those securities are called available for sale securities. So here we go. We have a few important notes. At the date of acquisition, we will record our investment always at cost, and at the date of balance sheet, we need to remeasure our investment to the fair value, and the changes in the fair value we will see where we will take it, okay, with the help of entries. So here we have double entries, relevant double entries, okay, to the available for sale security. The first entry at the date of acquisition, you will debit the available for sale security and credit the cash with the price, whatever you have actually paid. Then at the end of the balance sheet, you might have unrealized gains or losses. Unrealized gain mean to say maybe you have purchased a security for $10. Now could be a fair value, could be $8. So you might have a loss of $2 or you might have a gain. So you could have unrealized gain or losses. And don't forget, all these unrealized gain or losses, we will take it to the other comprehensive income, not to the income statement. Okay. In case if you have a loss, we will make debit fair value adjustment account and credit unrealized gain, which you will take it to the OCI. Now, maybe you are thinking, what is the fair value adjustment account? Actually, guys, what we will do, we are going to maintain two ledgers for available for sale security. The first ledger for the original cost and second ledger is for fair value adjustments. Like in this fair value adjustment account, we will record the changes in the fair value. But when it comes to the balance sheet, you have to report one value, one net amount in the balance sheet, which you will calculate this way: original cost plus minus fair value adjustment. And this should be the amount which should be reflected in the balance sheet. So you could have a loss also if there is a loss. So debit unrealized loss, which you will take it to the other comprehensive income and credit fair value adjustment. Okay. So this is what is the entry to record the unrealized gain or losses. The third entry, you might have invested in the preferred stock where you might receive certain dividend. So the what entry you will pass: debit cash or dividend receivable, credit dividend income. And don't forget this income, we will take it to the income statement. The fourth entry for the interest, if you have invested in the bonds, So you will receive the interest. So debit cash account or interest receivable, credit interest income, which you will also take it to the income statement. So here we go. When we will sell the investment, so this entry I will explain and you will understand better if we will do the question. So there, that time I will explain this entry. Okay. So here we have a financial statement presentation. In balance sheet, this is the summarized way. What we need to do, we can report our investment at current market value, either as current asset or non-current asset. Actually depends upon the purpose and the nature of the investment. Okay, so you can classify current or non-current. So, and in the equity section, what we need to do, we will record all unrealized holding gains or losses in the accumulated OCI. If you have idea about accumulated OCI, you know what we do. Whatever items you will write under the statement of comprehensive income, or you know, under statement of comprehensive income, there is a OCI relevant item. These OCI relevant item, you will take it to the equity section in the balance sheet as a accumulated OCI. You will transfer these OCI balance to this account. Okay. So this is what we will see also with the help of example, if you are not clear. So in income statement, what we will do, we will put all realized gains or losses, including interest and dividend. If you have invested in the bonds, you also need to take the amortization of premium or discount to the income statement. In other comprehensive income, I would say in statement of comprehensive income, under the statement of comprehensive income, you have other comprehensive income. There you will put only unrealized gains and losses. In the statement of cash flows, you will record the cash receipts or payments under investing activities. Okay, so here we go. Let's practice a question to understand in better way. So we have here a company, okay, Maverick Company. On April 1, year 1, this company purchased 1,000 shares of White Company mandatorily redeemable preferred stock at fair value. And this investment is classified as available for sale securities. On May 1, year 3, I mean, in the third year, Maverick sold all of its investment at fair value. And here we have our dates, and here we have our relevant fair values. Okay. This is your date of purchase. Fair value was 25. This is your date of sale. Your fair value was 31. And in between date of purchase and date of sale, we have two balance sheet date, which is year one and year two. And these are the market value. Now, the question is that what accounting entries you will pass and how you will deal with this investment. Here we go. At the date of acquisition, you should remember we paid $25 and we purchased 1,000 shares. So it means $25,000 you have invested. So you will pass this entry. Debit available for sale securities with 25,000. Credit cash with 25,000. That is it at the date of acquisition. But now at the date of balance sheet, you can look at here, your stock value is 32. At 31st December year one at the date of balance sheet, and you can check it here, there is a gain of $7 because you purchased for 25. Now market value is 32. There is a gain of $7 multiplied by 1,000 stocks are there. So total gain is 7,000, and this gain where you will record debit available for sale securities fair value adjustment account. Okay. Credit unrealized holding gain, which you will record into OCI, 7,000. Now, here we go, how you will record your investment in the balance sheet. First of all, under the asset section. So you will record your available for sale securities at current market value. And the current market value is $32 times 1,000 shares. So this is how you will get 32,000. And you can get this way also because previously your investment was 25,000 at the time of investment. You can check it here. Okay. Plus you have a gain of 7,000. So this is how you got a 32,000. And under the equity section, You also need to record under accumulated OCI this gain of 7,000. The reason is that because when you prepare the statement of comprehensive income, unrealized holding in, we will put it under OCI there, 7,000. And this unrealized holding in will be transferred to the equity section under the head of accumulated OCI. Okay. Now in year two, let's have a look what happened in year two. If you will go back to the question. In year two, we have a stock price of, if you will look at here, $27. And at previous balance sheet date, your stock price was $32. So there is a loss of $5. So number of stocks are 1,000. So total loss will be 5,000. And this loss, you will record this entry, debit unrealized holding loss of 5,000 and credit available for sale security fair value adjustment account of 5,000. Now, when it comes to your financial statement under the balance sheet in asset section, you will record your available for sale security at current market value, and current market value is $25, which will be multiplied with 1,000 stock, you will get 27,000. Or you have an original cost of 25,000 plus you have a gain of net remaining gain is 2,000, because previously your gain was 7,000 in year one, and in year two we have a loss of 5,000. So your net value is 2,000. So if you will take 25, which is your original cost, plus net changes, which is 2,000. So this is how you got 27,000. Don't forget, at the time of sale, we will remove this cost also, and we need to remove this gain also, okay, from the fair value adjustment account. Okay, so then here and under the statement of comprehensive income in year two, you will record unrealized loss of 5,000. Now look at here in balance sheet, again we have a equity section, we have accumulated OCI, previous balance was 7,000. And now you have a loss of 5,000. So what, you have a remaining balance of 2,000. This will be in the equity section. Now on May 1, year 3, this is your date of sale. At this date, you have sold the investment. You sold it for $31. So what entry you will pass? Debit cash, 1,000 times 31. It will be 31,000. Debit reclassification of holding gain from accumulated OCI. You remember, guys, we have in equity section, if I will show you, just let me highlight this value, 2000, we have under equity section, because we are going to sell this investment, so this value we need to remove. So to remove it, we will debit it by the 2000. You also need to remove, as I told you here, this cost and this fair value adjustment account also. To remove the cost, we will credit available for sale security by 25,000, and to remove the gain, we will credit, to remove this ledger account fair value adjustment account, so we will credit available for sale security fair value adjustment account by 2,000. And now you can look at here, you have removed all the relevant accounts from the financial statement, but there is a still difference of 6,000. This 6,000 is called your realized gain on disposal of available for sale securities. If you are thinking how you got this 6,000, I can tell you this way also. Here we go. Look at it. At the date of sale, what happened actually? Your value is $31, but your last value is 27. So you can look at here, you have a gain of $4 multiplied by 1,000. Total gain is 4,000 plus 2,000, you have a gain in OCI. So that is also going to realize now. Okay. So that 2,000. So this is how you got a 6,000 total gain, realized gain. Okay. So this is how you got this value, this 6,000. I hope it is clear. Okay. Now the presentation in Maverick at December 31st, year three financial statement, year three. What you will do in the income statement, you will put realized gain of 6,000 because it is realized, and statement of OCI, you have to reclassify of the holding gain from accumulated OCI because you removed that one. So that value should be subtracted. And this is your net gain, okay, which is will be recorded under the total comprehensive income 4,000. Okay. So this is how you will deal it. Now we have here, I hope you are clear with this. Now please focus. If you are CMA student, that is enough for you. But if you are CPA student, please look at this topic also. We have here impairment of available for sale security. First, you should remember, guys, what is the impairment? You know, impairment is the permanent reduction in the value of asset, right? Permanent reduction. So here, how you will calculate the impairment? We have few cases here. We have to remember available for sale debt security is impaired only if its fair value, okay, is less than amortized cost basis. Amortized cost for the timing, just you can remember because I didn't cover the bonds. We will see. Amortized cost means say whatever the value is previously recognized. Okay, that is called your amortized cost for the time being. So whatever is showing in the financial statement, okay, if our fair value is less than amortized cost, it means the asset available for sale security has impairment. So first, go listen me carefully. It's really important and little bit complex also. So what we need to do, we need to take amortized cost basis, which is recognized in the previous financial statement, minus fair value if it is less than amortized cost. So this is how you will get the maximum amount of impairment, okay? Like amortized cost minus fair value, because amortized cost will be greater than fair value. That is why your asset is investment is overstated and there is an impairment. So you have to record the impairment. So here, once you will get, you can look this arrow, maximum amount of impairment. Here you have to ask two more questions. Is there any credit loss exist? Credit loss mean to say, I will explain, don't you worry. If there is any credit loss, so you will record in the income statement, this impairment loss as a credit loss, you will take it to the income statement. If there is a non-credit loss, so what you will do, you will record into OCI. Now, maybe you are thinking, what is the credit loss? Let me just give you the idea. Actually, it is same like our receivables, you know, because when you are investing somewhere, of course, you will receive that money. So, and if you have a trade receivable, if you remember accounting for receivables, what we do, we write there gross receivable minus allowances for uncollectibles, right? Uncollectible nowadays, it's called credit losses, allowances for credit losses. This is how you will get the NRV. So NRV of receivables, same here. What we are going to check? We are going to check, is there any credit loss exist? Credit loss exist mean to say, maybe your borrower will not pay your money. So that is called credit loss. And how you can check your borrower maybe will not pay you 100% money back. So in this is how you can calculate, you need amortized cost basis, which is recognized in the financial statement. If it is greater than present value of cash flows expected to be collected, okay, from the borrower, if amortized cost is greater than present value of cash flows, it means you are not going to recover. Actually, this is the recoverable amount, you can say, huh? Recoverable amount from investor, okay, from borrower, I would say. If maybe you are not going to recover the full amount and your asset in the investment in the balance sheet is greater, so it means there is a credit loss exist, okay? The credit loss exists. If credit loss exists, so what we need to do here, we have to apply three scenarios. Scenario number one, if your maximum amount of impairment, which you have calculated here, if you look at here, which is equal to amortized cost minus fair value, which is maximum amount of impairment, if maximum amount of impairment is equal or less than credit loss. And credit loss, this is how you will calculate. How you will calculate? Amortized cost basis minus present value of cash flows expected to be collected from the borrower. Okay. So if your maximum amount of impairment is equal or less than credit loss, full amount, we will take it to the income statement. It is like a allowance for uncollectible account. So what we will do, we will make debit credit loss expense, like the same bad debts expense, credit allowances for credit losses. So here we go. Maybe you will better understand in the help of example. So here we have the following year-end information pertains to aerial company investment in available for sale debt securities. We have amortized cost of 100,000. We have fair value of 90,000. We have a discounted cash flows expected to be collected from security is, for example, 88,000. Now, first of all, what you need to do, calculate the impairment. And how we can calculate impairment is equal to amortized cost, which is $100,000 minus fair value, which is $90,000. It means you have an impairment of 10,000. This is your impairment. Now you have to check, is there any credit loss? Credit loss, how you will calculate? Amortized cost, just refer to the above formula, minus present value of cash flows expected to be collected from security, which is 88,000. So you can just minus, so you can look at here, your credit loss is there 12,000. And as I told you, if your impairment is equal or less than credit loss, full amount, you will take it to the income statement. Okay. And we will pass debit credit loss expense and credit allowance for credit losses. Okay. And scenario number two, you might have a different scenario also. Scenario number two is if your maximum amount of impairment, okay, and as I told you, the impairment, how you will get amortized cost minus fair value, okay, is greater than credit loss now. Previously, it was less than and equal. Now it is greater than credit loss. If this is the scenario, what you need to do, impairment up to the credit loss will be taken to the income statement, okay? And by passing the same entry, debit credit loss expense, credit allowance for credit losses. And step number two, what you need to do, impairment above the credit loss will be taken to the OCI as a unrealized holding losses, debit unrealized holding loss and credit available for sale securities. Now here, just let's have a look. I'm continuing with the same example. Don't forget, previously we have amortized cost 100,000 in the previous example, because that data I'm going to continue. We have now we have a fair value. Now this is the new information. Fair value, we have 85,000. Okay. And we have here one more point. Let me see what was that. The third point is discounted cash flows is 88,000. Okay. This value, it is the same, because now just we are going to change the fair value. So now we have a discounted cash flows, which is recoverable, is 88,000. Now what we need to do here, first of all, you need to calculate the impairment loss by having this data in your mind. So impairment loss, how I can calculate? So impairment loss will be equal to amortized cost, I'm writing in short, minus fair value. Amortized cost is how much? Is $100,000. Fair value is $85,000. This is your full value of impairment loss, which is 80, which will be $15,000. Now you also need to calculate the credit loss, which is equal to amortized cost minus discounted cash flows, recoverable discounted cash flows. And amortized cost is $100,000. Okay. And discounted cash flows are $88,000. It means your credit loss is 12,000. And now you can look at here, your impairment loss is greater than your credit loss. So if this is the scenario, amount up to the credit loss, you will take it to the income statement by passing this entry, credit loss expense, debit, and allowances for credit losses credit. Okay, and the difference you can look at here, there is a difference of 3000 because total impairment is 15, okay, but credit loss is 12. So there is a over and above value which is 3000. You will take debit unrealized holding losses 3000 and credit available for sale security 3000. Now maybe you are thinking how your investment will be reflected in balance sheet. In balance sheet, what we need to do, you will take amortized cost, which was 100,000, minus allowances for credit losses, which is 12,000, and minus we have unrealized loss also. I mean, so minus we have a one more thing, fair value adjustment also, which is 3,000. So 100,000 less 12,000 less 3,000, you will get 85,000, which is equal to the fair value of investment. And then we have a third scenario. I know it is a little bit complex, but try to absorb. Third scenario is what? If we have only impairment, there is no credit loss exist. There is no credit loss, okay? So then what you will do, full amount will be taken to the OCI as unrealized holding loss. We will pass this entry, debit unrealized holding loss and credit available for sale securities fair value adjustment account. So let me just have a put some data here just to make it more clear. For example, we have here amortized cost. I'm just assuming we are taking the same data first. We have amortized cost of $100,000. Okay. We have a fair value. I'm just assuming fair value of securities is, for example, $90,000. Okay. And we have where discounted cash flows, okay, which is expected cash flows, is also $100,000. Now you can look at it, you might have impairment, you have impairment loss. First calculate the full amount of impairment loss, which is equal to amortized cost minus fair value. Amortized cost is $100,000. Fair value is $90,000. So you have a full amount of impairment loss of $10,000. Now check, is there any credit loss? For the credit loss, what we will do, credit loss is equal to amortized cost minus discounted cash flows, which is recoverable. Okay, amortized cost is $100,000, and you can look at it, discounted cash flows is also $100,000. So it means there is no credit loss. Credit loss is zero here, right or wrong? So that is why, so it means there is no credit loss. It means full amount, we will take it, this full amount, which is impairment loss, we will take it to the other comprehensive income, and we will pass this entry, debit unrealized holding loss and credit available for sale securities. If you are confused here, it is a small summary you can understand in a better way. So here we go. Please follow this tree. Actually, if you have to check first question, is the fair value of an available for sale securities is less than amortized cost? If yes, it means there is an impairment. If no, it means there is no impairment. If there is an impairment, check next question. Does a credit loss exist? And credit loss, I told you how you will calculate. You will take amortized cost minus discounted cash flows recoverable. Okay. So if credit loss exists, okay, you will go to the next point. If your impairment loss is greater than credit loss, the portion of the impairment equal to the credit loss, you will take it to the income statement, and over and above value, you will take it to the other comprehensive income. If there is no credit loss exists, like credit loss doesn't exist, full value, you will take it to the OCI as unrealized holding loss. I hope guys it is clear. This is what you have to do under available for sale securities. See you in the next video. Bye-bye.